Well, greetings, Oakwood. If you have your Bibles with you, turn with me to Psalms 27. Now, I know these last few weeks I have been going through different Psalms. And the reason is, until I get clear direction about a book that the Lord wants me to go through with the church, I kind of default to the Psalms. Now, you know I like to go from verses 1 to the last verse of a book. But until I get that clear direction, I find in the Psalms gems that help us with our everyday living. If we go through psalm by psalm, we could always find something in it that will help us with our daily lives. So today we'll go through Psalms 27, verses 1 to 3. And then in the following weeks, we will finish off the Psalms. So let's read this. The scripture says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When evildoers assail me to eat up my flesh, my adversaries and foes, it is they who stumble and fell. Though an army encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. The war arises against me, yet I will be confident." Now, David writes this psalm in a moment of his life when he is going through a difficult situation. It seems that war is brewing right outside of his window. Where do I get this idea that war is brewing? Well, if you look at the passage, you see words like enemies and foes in verses 2, host in verses 3, war also in verses 3, and enemies in verses 6. These all speak of war. Phrases like, though a host encamp against me in verses 3, and though war should rise against me again in verses 3, all speak of battles being waged against David. It appears that he is in a difficult situation. However, it is also very clear from reading these verses that even in the midst of the battles he is fighting, David still has hope. Now, we are not sure of the exact historical situation. Charles Spurgeon, the Prince of Preachers, as he was called, guesses it may have been when David was on the run from King Saul, pursued by his enemies, shut out from the house of the Lord, separated from his parents, slandered by false witnesses. To him, it all seemed to fit. However, some will say that this is when Absalom, his son, had tried to take the kingdom from him. However, no matter what the situation, it was clear at this time that David was in an incredible crisis, and he was under much stress, and David finds himself praying for his life. Let me ask you, where do you turn when you are going through a difficult situation in life? When you are praying for your life, when you are worried about tomorrow or even a circumstance, what's the first thing you do? Do you go to God? Do you pray in that situation? You know I often talk about this, and I may sound like a beating drum, but I think it is very important for me to say it again, that our first resource in crisis or in any circumstances or when we are overwhelmed or burdened should not be to people. It shouldn't be to friends, it shouldn't be to families, not even your pastor, not even your church. It should first be to God. And yes, then you could go to those other individuals. But our first inclination of our heart should always be to run to God with our circumstances, to be open with God, to get on our knees and cry out to God about our situation, to take it to Him first. We cannot just get on the phone and start seeking advice from other people or going to magazines or watching TV shows or going through any other resource to get some form of comfort. No, we must go to God. So we see in this psalm, we can learn from David about praying when you are going through a difficult time. Okay, so what's the first thing that we can learn from David about praying when you are going through a difficult time? And I think the first thing is this, for us to have confidence in God. Look at verse 1. David begins by saying, "The Lord is my light and my salvation." What does David do? He claims God as his own. Notice a personal relationship with God. My light and my salvation. I think that is very powerful. That David is saying here that me and God have a personal relationship. So he's saying that God is my light. God is my salvation. He's talking personal. Now, can you do the same? Is the Lord your light? Is he your salvation? Do you know God in this intimate way like David did? Do you have an intimate relationship with God? I know a lot of people go to God when their chips are down. They cry out to God for help. And this is the sad part is many people in those circumstances who cry out for God to help, they don't have any relationship with God, and they don't know how to talk to God. So that's unfortunate. So you have to ask yourself, is the Lord your light and your salvation? That when you are going through a crisis situation, that you know how to talk to your God. Now, we see here that light is that which dispels the darkness. In the Bible, light can stand for life, God's blessing, or God's favor. The word for salvation here is Yeshua. Now, that's the Hebrew name for Jesus. And it is a word that speaks of God's ability to save and deliver from harm. Now, I think that is fascinating. But to appreciate what David is saying here, we need to remember that David was a mighty warrior. Now, this is going to become important as I go on. Now, as a teenager, he had gone one-on-one with the fearful giant Goliath. We all know that story. And we all know that he won. Before that, he had defeated his father's, he had defended his father's flock by killing a bear and a lion. Now, if Psalms 27 was written before he became king, while Saul was pursuing him, David had with him a tough bunch of fighting men. Now, if the psalm stems from Absalom's rebellion, David had with him an army of tough, seasoned warriors that had defeated all the enemy nations around Israel. It would have been easy for David to boast in his own strength or in the might of his army, but instead of doing all those things, he affirms that his defense is the Lord alone. Think about that. God alone. Even though he has probably tough men with him or a great army with him, David is actually saying that his defense is the Lord alone. Now understand, because of the fall, church, we all have the proud tendency to trust in ourselves. Be honest, we all do. We see this in the widespread notion that we can get to heaven by our own good works. You see people talking about it. You hear this all the time. Oh, as long as I'm a good person. So people think that the good that they do will get them to heaven. Sure. If you're really humble, you'll admit that we need a little boost from the Lord. Some people say, God helps those who help themselves, which is a concept that is not in the Bible at all. God doesn't help those who could help themselves. God helps those who cannot help themselves. So get that whole idea out of your head and never repeat it. But you have to understand, we take pride in our own goodness and in our own ability to commend ourselves to God. That's what we do. But the Bible strips us of any avenue of congratulating ourselves. Because what did the scripture say in Ephesians 2, 8 to 9? It says, for by grace, which is unmerited favor, that's what grace is. It means that you have not earned it. You have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God, not as a result of works that no one can boast. You think that Paul was trying to get in at an idea here, and I think he was. There's nothing that you can do to earn salvation. There's nothing in you that is good. Everything within us is evil. If it was not for the death of Christ on the cross, we all deserve to go to hell. So everything, even our faith, comes from God. He alone is our salvation. Now, we dare not trust in our goodness or our efforts or even in our own faith. So like David, we should be able to pray with confidence in God, that God is our light and our salvation, that we don't need to try to figure things out ourselves. All we need to do is trust in the finished work of Christ. That's what David is getting at for us, that we are people that need to trust in God. So when you're going through a crisis or in a conflict, have confidence in God. Oh, isn't that amazing? Have confidence in God. Don't have confidence in yourself. Don't have confidence in your friends. Don't have confidence in your church or in your pastor. Yes, God uses those tools to help you, but your first trust should be for you to have confidence in God. Okay. Another reason David had confidence in prayer and dealing with his circumstance was the inevitable outcome of his enemies. David realized that he had God's protection on his life. Look at verses 2. It says, when evildoers assail me to eat up my flesh, my adversaries and foes, it is they who stumble and fall. Now, David describes his enemies in graphic terms. They are evil men. They advance against him. They are ready to devour his flesh. He pictures them as wild animals with no compassion and mercy. But when they attack him, David says, they will stumble and fall. It's one thing if your enemy stumbles and then keeps coming right at you, but David says that they will stumble and fall. They will not succeed in their efforts against him. Now the word they is emphatic in Hebrew. They, not I, but they were destroyed. You see how it's emphatic? When they attack me, they will stumble and fall. So the stone they roll against David will roll back on them. The pit they dig for David, they will fall into themselves. Why? Because they are evil men. They are not on God's side, and therefore God is not on their side. It is not necessarily, church, a bad thing when evil men oppose you. It's not. Now, if godly people take a stand against you, that's a different matter. John Wesley prayed, Lord, if I must contend, let it not be with thy people. And you know, and I pray the same thing, but unfortunately, there's so much false doctrine out there. There's so much wrong belief. A lot of these pastors out there are just motivational speakers that are leading God's people to hell. So you have to speak against him. And you have to make the church aware. I know churches don't like to see stuff like this, but they have to be aware of the falsehood that is out there, that is being spewed from many pulpits. So pastors like myself have to call this out. But I, like John Wesley, pray that, Lord, if I must, let it not be with thy people. But oftentimes, I tell you, when I'm in a debate with a non-believer about things of the scripture, it always seems to be the Christian beside me or within the crowd that doesn't know what he's talking about that creates more conflict. So I have to present the gospel to this guy and pull down his beliefs. Then I have to turn to the Christian over here and show him that his beliefs and his understandings are wrong as well. That's one of the worst things that a person or a pastor could do. But guess what? This is the reality. People do not know what they believe. People don't even know the very foundations. And that's what you have with a lot of these ministers. Remember, the pulpit is such an attractive thing for many people. It gives some form of fame, some form of limelight to people, and they run to it just to boost their egos. However, they don't know what they are preaching, and they are not called. Therefore, they do more harm to the gospel. Okay, so I'll get off my soapbox. But church, we should not be surprised when the world hates believers. That should not surprise us. Jesus said it in John 15 and verse 8. He said, if the world hates you, keep in mind that it hated me first. He doesn't say that if the world hates you, oh no, try to make them like you. Or if the world hates you, go in the corner and cry. Or if the world hates you, hide out. He doesn't offer any form of comfort. He just says, keep in mind that it hated me first. So evil men hated Jesus. You know why? Because they hated God. Evil men hate Christians. You know why? Because they hate Jesus. It goes all the way back to the garden where God said that there would be war or hatred between the seed of the woman and the seed of the serpent. The wicked have always hated the godly. Now, Thomas Watson wrote, he said this, the thief hates the light, therefore would blow it out. That's very true. The thief hates the light. And what would he want to do? But blow it out. And that's with the ungodly. The ungodly want to get rid of the godly. So when ungodly men oppose you, take heart. It means that you are probably doing something right. Something that is honorable to God. Besides, God will never side with evil. Therefore, realize that you are protected by God and your enemies will stumble and fall. So what am I trying to say to you? You need to be confident in this. Confident in God and confident in the fact that God has your back. That God is protecting you. Just like David, those who were trying to roll stones on David end up getting crushed by it. Those who are digging pits for you will probably end up falling in those pits themselves. People who are devising plans to come against you, as long as you are God's, you will be protected. How you will be protected may be different from the other person, but you will be protected. God takes care of his own. So the house that they build to trap you in will be the same house that falls and crushes them. That's the reality. God will protect you. Now, the third thing that we can learn from David's prayer is that God is bigger than any problem you face. This is true no matter how large the threat. Look at verse 3. It says, though an army besiege me, my heart will not fear. Though war breaks out against me, even then I will be confident. Rotherham put that last phrase as this, in spite of this, I am trustful. And I like that. In a fallen world, church, it should not surprise us that evildoers abound and seek to harm the people of God. You may never actually be surrounded by an enemy army, but even if you are, the one who fights on your behalf is greater than all the assembled armies the world could possibly muster. You know what? David Good's friend, Jonathan, understood this perfectly when he said to his personal armor bearer, nothing can hinder the Lord from saving, whether by many or by few. Interesting enough, a few minutes later, the two of them took on and defeated an entire garrison of Philistine soldiers. Now, the prophet Elijah understood this perfectly as well when he took on 850 false prophets of Baal and Asherah, and God answered him with fire from heaven. Now, Elijah understood this perfectly when the army of Syria surrounded him. He prayed that God would open the eyes of his servant, who was nervous, and suddenly the servant's eyes were opened, and he saw the enormous angelic army that was poised on the mountainside, far greater, far more numerous than the army of Syria. Now, understand this, church. This should not be taken as an ironclad promise that no harm will befall you. Good and godly men and women have been persecuted, tortured, and martyred across all ages. See, when people make these false promises to you that everything will go well, those are false prophets. Those are false teachers. Those who tell you to send in money, or they'll send you this, or to pray this, all false. All false teachers. These people are charlatans. We are not guaranteed anything except eternal life. But what happens in this world is God's choice. But what we are given through this passage is the opportunity to meditate on the confidence we can have in God, knowing that God has good and eternal purposes for us. We can look at this passage, these three verses, and say God has good and eternal purposes for his people. Now, as I said before, it doesn't matter how large a problem you have or that you are facing, God is bigger than that problem. And you can have full confidence in God. So that doesn't mean, as I just said, that everything will turn out the way you want it. God in his wisdom may have different plans for you than you would have chosen for yourself. Now, Christians suffer. They grieve. They're not immune to sickness and sorrow. Remember, that's what the false teachers teach. Christians lose loved ones. They are imprisoned. Their dreams sometimes come crashing down to the ground. But God is faithful, and he will bring you through whatever problems you face. Hear that. God will bring you through whatever problems you face. God could be setting you up and positioning you now for something greater in your life. God could be bringing you through a problem right now because there's somebody he wants you to help. You don't know what God is doing. God is omniscient. That means that God is all-knowing. God knows it all. He knows the beginning to the end. So if he knows the beginning and the end, that means he knows the middle. He knows exactly what you're going through. And God right now at this time could be bringing you through the fire because he's positioning you to turn out to be gold. That's true. That's the truth. You know, when the potter is molding his clay, he bashes it, he crushes it, he presses it down, he forms it again and presses it down. Sometimes God is doing that to us because he's going to build something more beautiful than we could expect. So in the long run, even death cannot hurt the child of God, for death simply ushers us into God's presence. Okay, let me end with this. Think of all the things that God has done for you. The victories he has won for you. The enemies he has vanquished for you. The mountains he has moved and the victories he has won for you. Think of these things and remember that God, who performed countless wonders in the past, is still the same God today. That should give us, as his people, hope. Let's pray. Father, give us the ability to look back on our lives and see all the dots that you have connected for us, the pictures that you have drawn for us that we could not see before. God, give us the ability to trust you in our trials, knowing that you are molding us. You are forming us into your very image. God, give us that trust that we need to go on to the next day, to the next issue. Take us through, oh God. You've promised in your word that you will never leave us and that you will never forsake us. You would never let go of our hands, and we believe in that today. So God, give us the courage and the face and the faith to be able to face the enemies and the obstacles and the circumstances in our lives that trip us up. But let us, even when we're on our backs, always look up to you, knowing that you have our backs. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Until next week, I will see you again, Oakwood. Bye for now.